My presentation was initially going to be the music of the 1990s, then narrowed down to the rock music of the 1990s.
You can forget about ICT and Scoopy Scoopy Dog Dog.
Even this was too diverse, so I've narrowed it down to the rock music of the early 1990s, what some people call grunge music. However, when talking about this, we have to look back at the decade prior, the 1980s. So glam rock is often looked back at as being something comical.
I bet these guys like practice their little woofy dance moves.
But it began with integrity back in the late 70s and the early 80s, but eventually became watered down and oversaturated.
It was Whitesnake.
We're not Whitesnake, dude, we're Poison.
I thought we were Quiet Riot.
It says here we're Rat.
During this time, up the coast in Seattle, the youth are becoming increasingly frustrated by the lack of touring major artists were doing through their city.
Not many bands made their way up to Seattle.
We were just kind of left to our own devices to create our own community.
With the area being very working class at the time, all the musicians were drawn to music such as
Venom, Black Flag,
Black Sabbath, The Rolling Stones, Creedence Clearwater,
Dinosaur Jr.,
The MC5, Sonic Youth, R.E.M., Husker Du, Stooges,
Motorhead.
It was Mucus Army.
Still am.
Bruce Pavitt and Jonathan Poneman at this point decided to create Sub Pop Records to focus on this new sound coming out of the area. Early artists included bands like Soundgarden. It was Mother Lovebone, however, who were poised to become the breakout stars of the area.
Extra game.
This was all derailed, though, when lead singer Andrew Wood died of a heroin overdose. His death would greatly affect everybody else in the scene, changing the mood from upbeat and hopeful to downtrodden and gloomy. So now at the beginning of the 90s, Sub Pop really began pushing this new sound. So what exactly is this sound? While looked back at as being something groundbreaking and new, and that's really only true in regards to what came before it. Sure, it was different to glam rock, but it bears heavy resemblance to rock of the 1970s.
You know, it's sort of a rehashed thing, I think. It's more, the new sound is really an old sound.
Let's take a listen.
That's punk rock, and one day they just sort of started going, and that was grunge.
So stylistically, it was very similar to 70s rock, but musically,
it's actually much more complex than most people realize.
Rhythmically, it was a basic mid-tempo 4-4, but 7-4 also became a signature time signature. While looking at vocals from glam rock, it was much more controlled and precise, whereas looking at vocals from grunge,
like, it isn't quite straight on the note, which kind of echoes that uneasiness. Like,
that vocal cry, that gritty, growly shout at the top of his range.
That scream, first of all, sounds so tormented.
And of course,
singers from the 90s, why they all needed to turn every vowel into the letter A.
It used to be that you loved me, but now it's 1990.
The words are hitting hard.
Lyrically, things much more open than decades prior.
Lighten up, Francis.
And as far as the music theory goes,
four chromatic chord, he plays that flat seven. They like to use a lot of perfect fourth intervals.
Fourth,
a perfect fourth below. Sharp four, major seven, so that's a flat seven, sus four. So sharp four, sus four there. Seven, sharp nine.
Ninth to the root,
under the ninth.
That's the ninth of the chord.
The ninth of a nine is in the ninth of that chord.
No idea what you're saying right now.
You lost me.
Forget about it, Ian! Just play the thing!
Yeah, forget it. Just, come on, just play it.
Did you hear me talk about them? Ninths, elevenths, thirteenths. But it really is a characteristic thing of the grunge era.
Another characteristic is sudden dynamic changes. Drop tunings were also common.
In drop D, drop C sharp, or drop D flat, everybody used drop D in the 90s.
So, looking at studio techniques, guitar sounds were created by blending multiple amps.
I think it's 212 combo, yeah.
So you had that and a Marshall 412.
With the 2x12s that were open-backed being mic'd from the back.
The back, you do the back miking.
Another technique used to create a larger guitar sound is combining multiple amp heads and blending them together in different parts of the frequency spectrum.
The amp for the bottom, one for the mid, one for the top, and then kept the sound separated with high-pass, low-pass filters.
The guitar tones, though, are really brutal sounding. They're really great sound.
Other effects on guitars were distortion pedals, overdrive pedals, and fuzz pedals.
They were all using big muffs. All three guitar players had big muffs. And we came in a rehearsal one day and there was the sound in the room and it was like, what is that sound? Oh, it's this pedal.
There'd also be a lot of effects on bass.
I think I know what it is. Was it the SGX, the night bass?
Yep, night bass.
Night bass.
Nailed it, dude. You're good. Nice.
A famous example of this is the SPX 90.
Bass part on here has a flange on it.
For drums, it was the usual rock setup of a D112 on kick, 57 on snare, 421 on toms, 414s as overheads, and U87s as room mics. And to further enlarge these sounds, reverbs were often added, although not everyone liked the use of the reverbs.
Eddie Vedder used to say, oh, it sounds too produced or whatever. It's because it has a lot of reverb on it.
And something that really went against the idea of keeping things natural and organic is the use of drum samples. And these we used to give a
sense of hyper-reality.
Some notable producers from the era included
Mr. Dave Jordan,
who produced the first two Alice in Chains albums.
Brendan O'Brien, who produced Versus, Vitalogy, Yield, all those records.
As well as Butch Vig, known for producing Nevermind, as well as other artists like Smashing Pumpkins and Sonic Youth. Steve Albini.
I'm a prick.
Okay.
Who engineered Nirvana's final album, In Utero. And given that most artists were minimalist in their approach to recording and production, it was the role of these producers to create a bigger sound sonically without destroying the music.
I don't know how I got Kurt to do all those guitars. I think I kept saying, I think I was lying basically, saying there's a problem with the track, it didn't record properly, or it's out of tune or something. So let's just do it again. So he thought he was doing the same part over. Meanwhile, I just kept putting him to new tracks. So we ended up with the clean track and five guitar tracks. So now it's finally sounding like a rock song.
Everything was overdubbed individually.
But when it came to the performances, all the producers knew when to step back.
Best thing that I can do is just be as transparent as possible and get out of the way and give this guy the controls and say, here, you drive. You know, we'll decide, once we've comped your vocal, we'll decide if it works or not.
My main job, and it was a very difficult part of the job, was just making sure everybody got there pretty much on time. And I knew that if I got all these guys in the room and had it rolling and sounding great and they didn't have to do much to get to that point, that we were on fire.
Use the
John Lennon reference, and every time he resisted, I said, John Lennon did it, so he'd go, okay.
So now knowing that, getting back to the story, Sub Pop were heavily promoting grunge at this point, similar to labels of the 1960s.
And John and I, as fans of, you know, the history of pop music in this country, really admired labels like Motown and their hit factory
mentality.
This would come to a quick end, however, with Soundgarden leaving Sub Pop to sign to a major label. Nirvana would soon follow, signing to Geffen Records to release their second album. And at this point, it seemed inevitable that the Seattle sound was about to break out into the mainstream.
Band out of Seattle to really kind of bust big and with a video and the touring and stuff like that.
This almost didn't happen, however, as
radio stations all turned it down. They all said Lane's voice is wrong.
Never mind, however, would blow things open on a worldwide scale in a way that no one would expect.
Is this like grudge music? Grudge music is that stuff those guys from Seattle play. Hello, may I help you?
The enjoyment of this success, however, was short-lived, as many bands have become disillusioned with their success and fame.
This kind of success or trying to fulfill this kind of hype, it can destroy everything. It can destroy what's real. You know, it can destroy it. You know, it can make it a commodity. At whose cost? At yours. And you're supposed to be happy about it because you're successful.
This fueled already bad drug habits, with heroin often being the drug of choice, which also became the subject matter of choice in many songs. Dirt, for example, including Junkhead, Godsmack, and Wood. Wood being about Mother Lovebone singer Andy Wood, whose death years prior still wasn't enough to deter others from the same fate. In 1994, it was Kurt Cobain, who died of suicide fueled by depression and drugs. Next was Lane Staley, who became increasingly reclusive and eventually unrecognizable due to his drug habit, which took his life in 2002, where he was found dead supposedly 2 weeks after his time of death. In 2017, it was Chris Cornell, who died of a suicide whilst under the influence of prescription medication. All this leaving only Eddie Vedder as the last remaining singer from any of the big four grunge bands. Back in the mid-90s, these bands were beginning long hiatuses, calling it quits, or pursuing other activities, and labels started to look for anything to fill the gap. And in turn, were watering down the sound and destroying any integrity that was left. And this had completed the circle. And just as glam rock had been destroyed by the end of the 80s, grunge had now been destroyed by the end of the 90s.
Now you have become the very thing you swore to destroy.
So, in conclusion, the grunge era wasn't particularly inventive, musically or even production-wise, but instead was able to refine and perfect previous conventions, allowing the songs to shine, letting the music communicate directly, which is why each new generation can find something to enjoy in a bunch of depressing old songs.